must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day.
Good morning, everybody. Glad to be with you. Well, today is episode number 304. Right Thinking with Steve Coplon is very pleased to announce that this week's show is called Hardcore Blessed Part 4 with guest Tony Sadler. Tune in and hear Steve and Tony talk about preparing for the fight. Tony is a man who has weathered many storms. Hear his powerful story as he draws from his career as a professional boxer to face severe medical hardships and live a life of purpose. I'm very excited about today's show because this is Tony's fourth time, and I've always wanted to bring Tony's intense medical story, what he's got to go through every day for so long in his life. Because what we've been talking about Tony up to now, he's a remarkable man. He's a man of wisdom. He's got purpose. He's turned his life around. He gives to others, all these things. That's what we've been talking about. You've heard his testimony, but without knowing the depth of what he faces every day and his struggle, you just don't know what I know about Tony and why I respect him so much. I respect him greatly for all the great work that he does for trying to help youth keep their lives straight. But I promise you, just hang in here with us because it's time for Tony to share what he really has to go through, his perseverance and the strength, the internal fortitude. It's going to amaze you. Well, I guess that's pretty good, Tony. I've said a few things about you, Tony. Tony, thank you for being on the show with me again today. How are you doing today?
I'm doing okay, and I thank you for having me. And I'm looking forward to giving everybody some more information, and hopefully it'll help somebody.
Well, Tony, not to minimize everything that I've already said about you, it's your voice why I need you on here. You got the radio voice, and I've got whatever you want to call this thing that I do, but everybody talks about that voice that you've got. And James Earl Jones did call me up after the last show that we did when I said, James, you can retire now because we got a replacement for you. How you like that, Tony?
That's all right.
Yeah, it is all right. It's a thrill, though. I really do feel like I'm talking to James Earl Jones. Your voice is amazing. Well, Tony, what we're going to get into today, preparing for the fight, I've already talked a little bit a couple shows ago that you were on about how you're a professional boxer, but last week I brought the show called The Man in the Ring, and I told everybody that the title came from a conversation where you and I were getting real deep about how we face life and how it's like we're the person in the ring, that once you get in that ring, you're alone. Tony, I know that you listened to the show that I did last week. Could you relate to that show last week?
Yes, absolutely. It's a lot of very good information. And like you always have, Steve, that was really good information. And you kind of tied in some scriptures with it. And, you know, I felt like that was very good and needed.
What spoke to you, Tony? What spoke to you that I brought out last week?
Well, all of the scriptures that you brought out spoke to me, but I'd say one or two that I remember that kind of stood out with me was Philippians 4:13 and Isaiah 40:29. I think it was 40:29 through 41.
Yeah, I've got those right here. I'll share those again. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Isaiah 40:29 through 31, one of my favorite scriptures in my life. It's the one I said that I've carried a pocket knife around for years until you couldn't read the words because it got so worn away. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Everybody gets tired. Everybody gets weary in the struggle we call life. And it gets to a point that when we can't help ourselves, we have to call on someone else. I've never known anybody better to call on than the Lord. I'm not looking for anything better. If I see something that I think is better, I know that it's an illusion, because God is it and God has it. And it's for many people, it's not easy for them to ask for help. But when you get to a certain point in life when you can't go any further, you will ask for help. You will accept help. And God is offering it. He's offered help from day one.
Tony, one of the things that's so wonderful about our relationship is that your son Antonio wanted me to meet you. He loves you so much. We've told the story about, you know, your childhood and the troubles you went through. We've told his story, his years in prison. And y'all got closer together after he shared some things on my show. Then y'all got back to a conversation where a lot came out, a lot of air was cleared kind of thing. So in the future, we're going to have a show where both of you are on at the same time so we can really go. But
looking forward to that. He's
but your son, sending me to you because he loves you, and he thought that there could be something good come from a relationship that you and I could have. What he saw was that you and I were going to become close friends and that we could relate to one another. And I'll never forget our first two-hour conversation when I called to introduce myself to you, because we had 10 or 12 things that were just, we've both gone through some of the same stuff. And
knew some of the same people, it turns out.
Yeah. Some of those old karate people, Keith Vitale, that was one of the karate professionals that was in the circuit, that I knew some people that I fought in a few times. And you taught him hands to enhance his martial arts.
I teach him all of it. I worked with him some with the hands, and he showed me some kicks and stuff. But we were at, both of us were attending the University of South Carolina. I was on the boxing team there, and he was on the karate team. And if my memory serves me right, he became a world champion, or was a world champion or something at that time. Am I right?
You know, I think you are. There was this professional full contact karate, and then there was an organization out of South Carolina called SECA, Southeast Karate Association, that was one of the top organizations in the country. And, okay. And I know he was like their number one fighter in that organization for years. And if he went on to the world championship, he probably, I believe that he probably could have, because I just don't know. But Tony, you know, this whole thing that I drew from in a conversation with you a couple weeks ago was when I was sharing some of my medical circumstances that are very present right now, that I did my show last week on. I thank so many people for getting back to me after that show. I've had more responses from that one show than any show I've ever done. People said that, well, they thought there was something a little different about me, you know, because it was kind of serious what I talked about with, you know, my multiple myeloma being right back here after 16 years, getting ready to go through. I start my chemo in just a couple of days for oral chemo. I told that whole story, but here's my point. We've been wanting to tell your medical story because we relate. Your prayers have been incredible. And I even talked about how when I had my bone marrow biopsy, you were having your cataract surgery at the same time, and that I was actually praying as I was walking down to the surgical room for myself and asking the Lord to send my spirit to you as much as I wanted to give you all I had, because I knew I was going to be okay because the Lord was with me. You know the Lord's always with you. But we share so much, Tony. But the show last week that I so appreciate people that have connected back with me, it wasn't supposed to be a show about just what I'm going through. I used myself as an example so that I could show people where I draw my own strength, and to let people know that the same source, the same ways that I get my strength is available to everyone once you open up your heart. You know, that's kind of what the whole show was. And I, again, I thank everybody for listening to the whole thing and getting that out of it. But once you get into that ring, to go back to the boxer analogy here, I want to talk about when you're in life, and everybody is, but my point was the man in the ring, it wasn't just me. It's you. It's everyone listening is going to have times in their lives, storms, where you are basically alone from other people, where you gotta face it by yourself, but you're not really by yourself because there's a whole nother part of our lives that we're trying to talk about, and that's the spiritual side of our lives. And I talked about for myself, when I'm in that ring, proverbially speaking, the Lord is with me and I trust him and that gives me my strength. All the prayers that everyone sends to me that prays on my behalf are giving me strength. All the friendships and positive attitudes that I have are coming from so many other people that lift me up. And other than that, though, there's a whole, I'll call it an art, to the preparation that a professional boxer goes through that you can transition into the rest of your life. Because if you're not trained and prepared, you're not going to succeed. You know, so Tony, I just want you to go as long as you want to today. We got hours and hours. I'll break it into six parts of today's show if we have to. But talk about how you face life and what you've gone through. Tell them about your medical circumstances. Anything you want to share, Tony?
Okay. Well, Steve, talking about being a fighter, I've been a fighter basically all my life. Because I've had to be a fighter. I had asthma at a very, very young age. I don't remember not having asthma. And I had a severe case of asthma. And when it's like, I remember fighting for every breath of air and eventually passing out every night with my mother. She'd be down by the bed on her knees and praying and crying and giving me all kind of home remedies, because back then, the only thing that they had for asthma was Primatine, and they didn't have anything else. We had a lady that was a nurse. She used to give me like kind of bootleg penicillin to keep me from getting pneumonia. She said that if I got pneumonia, I would die. I just wasn't strong enough to endure it. And I remember that's probably some of the most suffering I've done in my life. And something like that would generate a lot of fear in a person, because we need air like we need nothing else. And when you can't breathe, that's a scary feeling. And you'll carry that fear with you through life if you don't find a way to deal with it. Now, with that, I think at around age 12 or something like that, I started trying to deal with it. Instead of just being a victim, I started trying to fight asthma. I forced myself to get out and run and play and just do everything. I lived. I decided I was going to live. I was tired of sitting on the sidelines. I said, if this is all I got, if I got to be like this the rest of my life, I felt like I didn't want to live. So I got out and I tried to do everything everybody else did. I was sick an awful lot. I paid for it. But you know what? It taught me something. And that is the best way to deal with adversity is to face it head on. Just to walk right into it with your hands up and your chin down and take it. Take it like a man, do your best. And that's what I did. And by the time I was age 18, I was strong enough to enter the Marine Corps. I went in the Marine Corps, and if anybody's never heard, I shouldn't have to tell you, the Marine Corps boot camp is the hardest boot camp out of all of them. It's extremely strenuous. And I was real proud that by that time I was able to carry the flag. And man, the guys would always be on me about how hard I run. They said, man, Sadler, slow down, man. You got to slow down. You're going to run us to death. For me, that really was a source of pride. I was lucky to be in there. And I think that after that, sometime after that, asthma just kind of started sitting on the sidelines. It wasn't the big problem that it was. Now, I've had some respiratory issues since then. Pretty much, I still have some. You know, they're not severe, though. They're nothing like they were. But all of that, I say that I made it on my mother's prayers because I didn't know the Lord at that time. I knew of the Lord because my mother was a praying woman. She was a Christian woman. And my dad was a Christian, but she was a Baptist and he was a Methodist. And I think our family went to church together once or twice, as I can recall in my life. He didn't like the way Baptists worshiped, and she didn't like the way she felt like the Methodist preachers didn't have any passion. And he felt like the Baptists were over the top, that there was just too much theatrics in the church for him at that time. But I mean, I can deal with either. It's just as long as I get the word. At this time, I can deal with either. Neither one's a big problem. It's not a problem at all, really. But let me go back to my health. I sort of puttered along, being able to do most of what I wanted to do in life without any severe health issues until when I was in the Marine Corps, I injured my back. I injured my lower back, and they told me that I was going to have back problems all my life from that. And that resulted in a medical discharge, on honorable discharge, but it was under medical conditions. And I thought they were wrong for a while because I said, man, I was strong. You're young, you're strong. You can overcome your illnesses and your disabilities and all. You can overcome it if you have enough willpower. Willpower is a big key to facing any kind of adversity. Well, I found out in time that they were right and I was wrong about it because it came on like gangbusters later on. And in respect to my spinal problems, I'm sitting in a motorized chair now that I use sometimes. I try not to use it all the time, but this time of year, I use it a lot. But my legs have been affected by it. My spine is got a lot of nerve damage that extends down to my legs, and I got nerve damage in my arms. And my neck is getting to be a big problem now. And in, I think it was 1999, I had a surgery and the surgery failed. It was, I think the physician was somewhat new. And he said, he told me afterwards, he said he went in there in my back and he found that it was more wrong than he thought was wrong, and he tried to fix everything he could, and he apologized to me. But it messed me up. It messed me up way, way worse than I was. I regret it. I tell people now that don't have back surgery for pain. If you have back surgery, if something stops working or if something is starting to stop working, have surgery to prevent that. Or something, but don't have surgery to get out of pain because it doesn't work. You're always going to end up in more pain. Most cases, sometimes little simple surgery. I think discectomies are pretty good. If that's your only problem, they can get in there and get the disc off the nerves, and you kind of be okay for a while. But the more serious spinal problems, if it's just pain, I'd advise somebody to endure that until they have to have surgery. Me, I could have went a little longer, and I should have, but I didn't. And as a result of that, I've been through just about everything. I'm on my second spinal cord stimulator, in the implant. The first one lasted me about 11 years. And I've had this one in about 3 years. And it helps some, but nothing helps a lot. I take morphine around the clock. I think you were asking me about it yesterday, and I was telling you, I'm advised not wait until it wears completely off to take the other one, because then you're going to try to beat the pain down. But it's better to take it before the pain gets to the level where it's just unbearable.
How many years have you been taking a low-dose morphine around the clock?
I would say, well, with morphine, probably about 5 years. But I also, for a while, they treated me with methadone. And they treated me with, I've been treated with everything. For a while, it was hydrocodone and oxycodone, every type of, I had some digestive problems. And I can't tolerate NSAIDs. So that's one problem. And they ended up giving me narcotic painkillers. And that's why I'm still taking them. Here I am 20 something years later, and I still have to take them. I don't think I'll ever be off of them unless someday devise something new. But I do work hard on getting my doses down. I'm at a dosage now that's probably 25-30% lower than it was at the beginning of the year. So I'm able to do a little more when it comes to things that require a clear head and everything. But it's just, it's something to go through. And, you know, you never get used to it. It's a level of pain that a person can endure on their own. There's a level of pain beyond that, that even with medication, you're going to struggle to endure it. And you hear people say they don't wish this on their worst enemy. I don't wish this on nobody. It's a severe impairment of your life. So many things I want to do that I won't say I've lost hope, but realistically, I know that at my age, I'm not likely to get any better. I'm going to try. I'm always try, but I just don't have a lot of confidence that I'm going to get better. But God can do anything. So that's my last hope. And he may deliver me from it. He may deliver me.
Tony, let me make sure I'm following you. Okay. As a child, you had really bad asthma.
Mm-hmm.
Went to the hospital a lot to get some breathing treatments when you couldn't be breathing, and your mom and helped you through, a nurse helped you through that with some medications. You went into the Marine Corps. And you had an accident, and you had a spinal injury, but between the Marine Corps and when the spinal injury got really severe and it became a daily 24/7, you know, medication with narcotics going back 20 some years, and finally into low dose morphine.
I had a life.
You had a life, and I want to go back to that in a second. But before we do, I want to get it all out for a second here, because we've been doing it. This is our fourth time, and we always sort of going to get to it, but we never do.
Okay.
You're a diabetic as well.
Yes.
What other serious medical conditions do you live with? Because I'm telling you, I know your inventory. I'd like you to, you know, what else do you go through?
Steve, I've had two heart attacks. One of them was a massive heart attack. And the strange thing about it, I don't even know when I had it. But I went for a stress test, and when they came back in, they were telling me, say, yeah, this was probably when you had your heart attack. I said, whoa, what heart attack? He said, you had a massive heart attack. I said, well, when? I said, I've never had a massive heart attack. He said, oh, yes, you did. They verified my name. He went in another room to look at the records again, and he came back and said, and he made sure that was me. He said, you've had a massive heart attack. And sometime after that, I think it was maybe a couple of years, I had another one and ended up in the hospital. That's when they put two stents in my heart. and I felt better. That helped me. And I don't think I've ever had a weak heart. I just had some defects. And I maybe, well, I think high blood pressure might have been the real culprit in it, because I've had high blood pressure. I've been taking high blood pressure medication since I was 22 years old.
50 years, 49 years.
And I don't believe I would be alive if I hadn't taken it. And I take it religiously. My father had high blood pressure. He had a massive stroke at 41 years of age. And he lived another 13 years. Mm. And he passed away from strokes and diabetes, strokes. And, you know, we got better medicine now, better doctors and everything than we had back then. So, you know, I've lived longer than he has. My mother died from a stroke at 65, stroke and kidney disease. So I've got a little touch of all of that. You know, high blood pressure is hard on your body. But I don't consider myself as being weak, neither physically or mentally. I mean, I'm gonna always try to do everything I can do to better myself, to overcome the adversities that are in my way. And I think my feeling is that adversity is at the core of all of our lives. You're gonna always face some type of adversity. I mean, whether it's physical or spiritual or both, you're gonna face adversity. And a person would best find some strategy, learn how to deal with it, learn how to overcome it, because it's coming. And some, if you live long enough, it's coming. I don't know anybody that hadn't been through something, and a lot of people been through more than I have. I don't think there's a whole lot of people, though. I think I've been through a little more than most people have. I had an aneurysm. Now, this was the one that almost killed me. This is what, I had a cardiac catheterization one day back. This is probably about 10 years or so ago. And the next day, I attended a meeting for strategies to deal with chronic pain. And the chair I was sitting in, it wasn't that comfortable, but I think the big problem was I felt like I had a pain. I thought it was my belt. And I remembered it when the day before, when I had that catheterization, the physician seemed like he had a hard time with the vein, getting in there and getting it out and everything. It just seemed like he had to pick, and, you know, I've had more than one cath, and that's the only time that I went through that, all of that with it. Well, the next day, as I said, I went to a pain clinic meeting, and on my way home, I felt this pain, and it was building up and building. It was right down between my navel and my groin on the right side. And I pulled up at home, and I got ready to get out of my vehicle. I stepped out, and my foot hit the ground. It really did feel like somebody had shot me in my abdomen. It felt like a bullet or something hit me. And I kind of went down like that. And it felt like it was building up. And it really felt like it was moving. It felt like it was going up, slowly going up toward my heart. And I got scared, and I took my belt off, and I tied my belt around my waist here, my stomach, above where I was feeling the pain at. And I got and went in the house, and I told my son, Antonio, I say, son, you got to get me to the hospital. I say, something is wrong. I say, something is bad wrong. And he got ready real quick. And I think he ran out there. First, he didn't have any shoes on. I said, you better get some shoes on. And he broke the speed limit getting me there to the hospital. And when I got there, they examined me. And they said that I was having, they said I had what they called, at that point, it was called a pseudo-aneurysm in my abdomen. And the way they explained it to me is that the vessel that goes down through there, you got two vessels that go down into your thigh and your femoral artery on each side. And this one on my right side, it was bulging. And it was causing a lot of pain. So they admitted me in the hospital. And later that day, the young doctor, I begged her not to touch it, but she kept wanting to see how big it was and where it was and everything. And she came up and she was poking and she said, "I'm not gonna hurt you." And it was excruciating. And then she pushed and boom, the thing just ruptured. And I lost 4 units of blood. My blood pressure was down to the 40s over the 30s. And I really thought I was gonna die. I was just sweating, throwing up. My legs had gotten cold and I couldn't feel my feet. I mean, I've never experienced anything like that before. And I think I was dying.
How old were you then?
I was probably 60, 61 or 62 or something, somewhere like that.
Okay.
And my wife and my kids, all of them came in the room that I was in. They just walked back to the back. To be honest with you, I yelled out for her because one of the nurses, I didn't think she was treating me right. I felt like she was being harsh and wasn't doing anything to try to help me. And I knew I was dying. And they were running around and all excited, and I wanted some help. So my wife and my kids, they walked right back there. And when they got back there, our solution was to pray. They started praying. Everybody laid a hand on me. Somebody was holding my hand. Somebody was holding each foot. And my wife had a hand on me and was wiping vomit out of my nose and everything so I could breathe, because I was actually throwing up through my nose and my mouth. And it was in a very extreme situation. I pray. I don't want to go out that way. I mean, I don't want to go out no way, but I don't want to go out especially that way, because it's kind of scary, to be honest with you. I didn't have but when something like that happens, you know, when you feel like, well, my time has finally gotten here, my time is up, you're not going to feel good about it. Well, you might. Some people might. It depends on the situation. I was ready to endure some more pain, put it like that. I wasn't ready to leave at that point. And but with them praying, and again, I credit that with making what the doctors were doing. They strapped some type of device around my waist, and I stopped losing blood. I was about to bleed out internally, and I never felt like that. I don't ever want to feel like that again. My legs and feet were just completely numb.
Did they rush you into surgery?
Well, they were going to send me down to Charleston, or where they was calling to get me downtown first. And when I'm trying to see if my wife is in here. I know how fantastical this sounds. But when they were praying and had hands on me, I stopped getting worse. And the doctors came in and told me that she said, "Well, your blood pressure and everything is starting to stabilize." And it actually started to rise a little bit. It still was pretty low, but it was going up. I wasn't losing any more blood, and it wasn't still dropping. But I survived it, and I say by the grace of God, only by the grace of God, I survived that. And I think that is as sick as I've ever been. And the thing about it, It was totally unexpected. I left home that morning. I had no idea that I was going to be, that before the day was over, I was going to be at death's door. I had no idea. But I'm so glad and I'm grateful that I'm still here. You know, all of the things people, when they, you think you prepared, and I don't mean to discourage anybody, because a lot of people are going through things that are or should be kind of scary. But people that find strength in God find the best strength. And many times they don't just find strength, they find healing. And that's what I found. It took me a while to get better. They asked me if I wanted, the doctor gave me a choice. He said, did I want blood? And I didn't feel good about them giving me blood. So they said, they instructed me to go home and eat a lot of vegetables instead of just rest. And it took me 2 months, at least 2 months before I could get up out of bed and walk around with any, have any strength, anything.
Tony. Mm-hmm. While we're on your extreme medical circumstances, I want to just spend another couple minutes if we can, because I want to get back to your professional boxing days and okay. What you learned to have this attitude where you can persevere and gut it out and all those kind of things. And I want to talk to you about training so that we can talk about not just physical training, but how you train yourself mentally and then how it transcends into a spiritual relationship that helps you. Okay. We're going to get to that in a second, but are there any other inventories? I'm going to be like a doctor. I've been into so many doctors. I've got a lifetime of being around doctors, as you know. That's one thing that we relate to here. But, okay. You know, so I have a little expression, head, shoulders, knees, and toes. I've had something going on with from the top of my head to my toes, literally, with all kinds of things. And how about you? Have you left out anything that's been a very major thing that you have to face on an ongoing basis medically?
Cancer. I'm still going to doctors about cancer. I had prostate cancer, and I had high dose radiation and hormone therapy as treatment for that. And that was painful procedure, very painful for me because I fancy myself as somebody that can handle pain as well as anybody. I mean, like you said, being a former boxer, I mean, you're going to have pain every time you get in the ring, you're going to get pain. Pain is a part of that life. But some things are kind of over and above. And cancer, I never had one symptom from cancer. I just, when I went for a physical and my PSA was sky high, and my doctor, my primary care physician, told me that he was going to order a biopsy because he said he was pretty sure I had prostate cancer. And what he said was that anytime he's ever seen a PSA score that was that high, they had prostate cancer. He said he never saw one up at that level that they didn't have prostate cancer. So his experience led him to be sure about it, and biopsy validated his suspicions. And by that time, the local VA was having a lot of problems with physicians and people that lost morale about going there to be treated. And I was one of them. So I called cancer treatment centers in Newman, Georgia. And they considered that the Atlanta center. I called them and told them what my situation was. And they told me when the biopsy report comes back, they call and get it. And they gave me an immediate appointment. And I went down and I had to go through the treatment for it. And it worked out, but I'm not done. I have to go back next month. And I'm hoping I get a good result.
Tony, We're talking about major back spinal column injury.
Right.
Talking about years and years of narcotic medications. We're talking about diabetes. We're talking about heart attacks. We're talking about aneurysms. We're talking about cancer. I don't want you to leave anything out, Tony, because I don't want people to think that you're like some kind of a, you know, exaggerations here. I'm just playing with you now, Tony. You've got too much that anybody should have ever had to go through. You got anything else that is on your list so that it's a complete list?
Let me think. Go head to toe.
head to toe.
Disc in my neck. I have a disc in the thoracic spine and two in the lumbar spine. Multiple surgeries on the back. Fibromyalgia. What else?
Hey, that's okay. I got to
tell you about this one. I was living in North Carolina then. I went to Presbyterian Hospital to get a stress test, cardiac stress test. When they were checking me in for the stress test, my blood pressure was so high that he told me, said that we're going to cancel the stress test and admit you in the hospital. I said, well, I got to go back home. He said, no, you come in the hospital right now. And he told me, sir, your blood pressure is. And it turns out it was, bottom number was about 180 and the top number was 250 or 260 or something. And my heart was racing. They couldn't get it to slow down. They think that might have been caused by a medication that I was taking for my blood pressure, something called Procardia. And I stayed in the hospital about a week and a half for that. And they didn't do any surgery or anything. They switched medications and I'm still here. That was probably in 1990 or 91 or something like that. I mean,
it's... Tony, we have qualified you for the grant that I'm going to send to you. Yeah, the grant that I'm going to...
We'll have another physical with it.
Yeah. I got this picture that I'm wearing a white doctor's coat and I got a stethoscope around me instead of this necktie. And I got this rubber mallet and I'm tapping you on your knees to see if you got any feeling. And don't kick me too hard when I tap your knee, okay? Now, Tony, I wanted to get past, I told you that in all these shows we've done, every time we finish a show, I never had got people to understand all that you face, all that you've gone through. But now I don't want to disappoint people that have listened. You're a tough man. You know, you've gone through so much. But I want to go back now and talk about specifically, because that's why we're having this show today.
Mm-hmm.
We want to help other people that are going through any kind of hardship develop a mental toughness, an ability to face pain, to go through their hardship, and not lose hope. That's my goal, is to help people not lose hope. And so, Tony, let's go back before we get into the spiritual aspects of not losing hope and where we draw our real strength from. Let's go back to, let me lay it out real clear. When I tell people that we're all going to be faced with hardships, we're going to have storms in life. And mm-hmm. they come, you need to face it in certain ways. We're going to get to that in our summary here, of course.
Right.
But what I'm looking for is, I said this, when I'm in the ring, proverbially speaking, when I've got to face these really difficult times, I say that all the people that are slapping me on the back, Steve, you got a great attitude. Wow, you're really something, the way you handle it. I like that. But mm-hmm. when I go through these things and I get into that ring, and I have all those prayers that people have given me, what I've got when I enter that ring is basically, I've got relationship with the Lord that I give myself up to carry me through. I got that. I got prayers of other people that I draw strength from. I've got all my own experiences. But I say for the detail that I'm coming to you, because you are a professional boxer that knows how to train the body to be rock hard, iron strong, you know? The thing is, the preparation and the training is what's critical. Now, you can have the strongest faith in the world, and there are miracles, and God might carry you through because it's not your time. And you've discussed a miracle that you had when your family prayed and laid hands on you in a hospital, and you didn't have to go through surgery. That's true. But for some reason, you know, that doesn't happen all the time. Sometimes people think that healing, I did the song last week, Laura's Story Blessings, where I sent people the song. You know, healings aren't what some people think. Sometimes healing is being able to endure the pain, not really look like you're getting better, to prepare yourself more for the eternity that you're eventually going to experience. In other words, it's not your time yet, but your life's not going to be easy until you get there. And other people, now I want to get real deep with you here. I want to talk boxing, professional boxing, how you train so that you can face the toughest things that are getting ready to happen to you. What's your mentality as you go into training?
Well, as I told you before, my mentality, my philosophy is that the training should be the hard part. The fight, you train hard enough, the fight is easy. It's easier than the training. Being in tip-top condition, being strong, having a tough mindset and an iron resolution, and knowing yourself, knowing your limitations, knowing your capabilities. To me, that's what makes a good fighter, a successful fighter. I've never been knocked out. I've never been knocked down in a match. Wait a minute, I got knocked down sparring one time. It was a policeman I sparred with back in North Carolina. He landed a good shot out of the blue, and I went down and got flash knocked down. I got right back up. But I've never been knocked out. And I can remember one time that I felt close to being, I thought I was close to being knocked down. And it felt like you're watching a TV, and it's like somebody jerked plug out and stick it right back in there. That's what it was like to me. It's like, oh, and I realized I'm in the ring in a fight. For a second, I didn't know where it was, but for a split second, and then I went right back to fight.
How many times did you fight in the ring as a professional fighter?
Well, four times, and most of my boxing experience was amateur. I think I've amateur, including collegiate. I probably had about 200 and some fights, close to 300. And I fought out of my weight class. I was a strong fighter. I had a good physique. I looked bigger than I was. And I was a light heavyweight at the end of my career. I was light heavyweight. And I was always having to fight heavyweights. I was always in the ring with heavyweights. Everybody, I couldn't get work a lot at the end of it. I couldn't get work.
Tony, when you train for your fights, you talked about the training has to be harder in the preparation than when you're actually in the fight. And the example that I want to relate to the listeners, if you're in a fight and you've never gone 15 rounds, so to speak, and your training wasn't that hard, and you get into the seventh, eighth, ninth round, and you realize this fight's not going to end. I can't stop this guy. I can't put him down. He's not going to put me down. But your ability to be in good enough shape to go those extra five, six rounds, it's a nightmare to be out there in a place where it's the unknown. When you're into that unknown territory where you've never been there before, it's not good. It's not good because that's what we're trying to talk about. You don't know yourself because you've never been there before. So what I'm really trying to, and that's kind of where I wanted to go with today's show. When you're in the fight for your life and in a hardship. You know, you've never had this financial crisis that you're suffering through before. Your family's getting more and more unstable. Your marriage is getting unstable. You got all these crises happening. You've got to be able to maintain calm in the storm, or you're going to do something dumb. You're going to do something stupid. You're going to do something that you're not experienced at, and you're going to be hit, and you're going to land on your butt, and you're not going to know what hit you. So what I want to end the show with, we've got about 5 minutes right now.
Okay.
I want to end the show with some really hardcore blessed advice about all that a person goes through with hardships and crises, and the preparation that you can do to be ready to face things, so that if something comes your way in life, you can do so much when you're healthy and strong in a good frame of mind to be prepared for the things in life that are coming. And I want you to just, what are those things? Just make a list of things for a minute or two here of what you think a person should do to face hardships in life.
Well, for me,
I want you to give it to people, because you've demonstrated that you're still standing. You're still here. So I've gotten so much from you, myself, and our relationship. I just want you to give it to some other people right now.
I'd say daily prayer is at the top of my list. Having a relationship with God. I mean, because how can you ask anybody to perform a miracle for you or to help you if you don't even know them? You know, it's nature to get help from people that you have some type of relationship with that you know. The other thing is being mentally prepared. All of us, our lives are finite. We have to realize that, and we have to accept that. Now, we don't have to just give in to it being finite, but we got to accept the fact that one day we're going to leave here. And once we do that, then we do all we can to make that one day be way in the future. Keep yourself in good health. Visit your doctor often. Follow the instructions. And one of the biggest factors that will determine how long a person's around is what you put in your body. If substances will kill you, eating the wrong way will kill you. I see people do what I call recreational eating. I hear a lot of people say, what we gonna do? What you wanna do today? Let's go eat something. That's like going to the beach or something to them. It's not the same. You eat for sustenance. You eat so your body would have the energy to function. I mean, and I know we also like to eat for taste. We do it. I mean, that's human. But to make a hobby of eating is not a good thing. You're going to get sick from the stuff you put in your body. You're either going to get sick or it's going to make you healthy. You eat the right things, you're going to be healthy. Eat the wrong things, you're going to get sick. And I'd say nowadays, use everything that medical science has at its disposal. Genetic testing is a good thing. Know your body's tendencies. Know what it's set up to do, what its propensities are. If you know that, then part of the battle's won. You can catch certain things before they even start. And I would say exercise. Usually a fit body is a healthy body. And if you are able to walk or move around, you don't have any excuse to not get exercise. I mean, for me, if I were healthy, I'd do it every day. But because I like exercise. But I think everybody can do it, can get some kind of workout 2-3 times a week. And it's particularly important as you get older. And I think those things, to me, are at the top of my list. And have something to live for. Keep good, close family ties. I love my family with all my heart. And they've been my motivation. They've been my motivation to keep going. There have been times, I'm not going to lie, there have been times that I felt like throwing in the towel. There's just periods of time where I've been through unbearable pain. And that was all I had to look forward to every day. I couldn't go and enjoy myself. I couldn't do anything and just lay in the bed and hurt, lay in the bed and suffer. I mean, that's not good. It's not healthy for you. It's not healthy for your mentality. But when you have people that you love around you, people that love you, you're going to fight. Even if you're not a fighter, you're going to fight. But I don't mind saying I am a fighter, and I'm going to fight. I'm going to fight till ain't no fight left in me no more.
Tony, I've enjoyed sharing your story with everyone because it fills in a great deal of the background for why at this point in your life you have dedicated yourself to just trying to help mostly young people straighten out their thinking so that they don't have to go through some of the stuff that you went through yourself. And your teachings on that are wonderful. And I encourage everybody to go back to the other episodes. They're all called Hardcore Blessed 1, 2, 3, and 4. So Tony, I'm gonna just sum it up real quick here. Everything you said is just right on target in my mind, and you're really doing some great things with your life right now. You've gone through so much, and I thank you for all the good work you're doing. There's a song that I want to end the show with, and I'm not gonna sing it. I just want to share a few lyrics with you because I think it sums up where you and I are both at right now in this message we've given on just persevering, facing up, you know, preparing yourself. And here's what it is. It's a song called You Never Let Go. And the singer is Matt Redman. And the song is, it's another of these Capitol Christian Music Company holds the rights to the song. But here's the just first basic couple stanzas of the song. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh, no, you never let go. Through the calm and through the storm. Oh, no, you never let go. In every high and every low. Oh, no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go of me. Tony, God bless you. Thanks for sharing more of your story with us today.
Thank you for that.
You're welcome. I look forward to the next time we can get together and try to shed some light on anything that'll help other people have a better life.
Thank you, Steve. I appreciate it. Looking forward to the next time.
Tony, God bless you again. And everyone, I hope that you've enjoyed, you know, just relating to the story of a man that's not going to stop. He said that. He's not going to stop till his last breath. So, you know, just call me, call Tony. If Tony's a guy that you want to get to know and relate to, he'll spend time with you. I know that he will. He spends time with me. He's doing a lot for me. He uplifts me. God bless everyone. Have a great week.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Copeland. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you and have a great week.